Right, so with this, ladies and gentlemen, we're also approaching the end of this event, and I think this is a high time when we move into the summarizing phase or the concluding phase, or also a phase where we directly talk about the theme of today's event, changing landscape of building strong brands. And we've got two industry veterans to do the same with us. To begin with, I would be inviting our keynote speaker for the day, Mr. Sumit Sawhney, who is the Managing Director and CEO for Renault India. He's been the same since January of 2014. Prior to this, he was handling the entire operations. Prior to this, he was also the Executive Director of Marketing and Sales at Renault India. And prior to that, he was the Vice President of Sales and Marketing and After Sales at General Motors. Ladies and gentlemen, we would also like to invite Mr. Pradeep Dwivedi, the CEO for Sakal Media Group, and they would be indulging themselves in a one-on-one chat, but to talk to you about Mr. Pradeep, he's an accomplished industry leader with an experience of over 23 years of business management, cutting across various functions and industries. He's also an active participant in many industries associated, such as the International Advertising Association India chapter, as Honorary Secretary and Managing Committee Member, and the Advertising Club of India as a Managing Committee Member. Ladies and gentlemen, with a thunderous round of applause, please welcome Mr. Sawhney and Mr. Dwivedi as they join us on the stage. Welcome, gentlemen.
I think we have the privilege of Mr. Sawhney here, so if I can indulge the audience in an address from Mr. Sawhney, and I think we'll pick up some very interesting cues from there and then have a one-on-one, if that's okay with you, sir.
Good evening, everyone. Building brands, I believe for the last couple of hours, this is what exactly you are listening to and you are discussing. And when I was on my way to this event, in the flight, I was thinking, what should I talk? You know, I'm a keynote speaker. And I'm sure that since afternoon, you would have been listening to a lot of jargons in marketing, because I think that's where all the marketeers start with. So honestly, I wish not to get into that side of the discussion. I believe marketing today is more of conversation than communication. So I will be more interested in having a conversation rather than communication. So I would just briefly share a few thoughts, a little bit of the journey. And after that, with Pradeep, we can have some conversation and then, you know, it could be an open house. So as you saw, my journey largely has been in automotive space. Different functions. And finally ended up as CEO. But one thing I can say, the reason I am in this industry is because I love this industry. So there's this passion of mine which drives me towards this industry. And when we are seeing the changing world, means I have been in this industry from an era where customer used to queue up outside the dealership to get his car, paying premiums, to today where customer is the king. So I think as marketeers, you would have also realized things have changed completely. And in this new era, in this new landscape, it is becoming more and more challenging to build strong brands with conventional ways. What I strongly believe is, you know, if you have to build a strong brand, you have to build it from your heart. Building a strong brand is like raising your own child. So I'll share my journey with you, because as in my introduction, it was said that I was working for General Motors. Most of my automotive life has been with General Motors. And when I was moving from General Motors to Renault, at that point of time, it was a tough decision. Because when I was with GM, till my last days, the brand was doing good. We had achieved a very good market share, strong brand. And at that point of time, a thought came in that, you know, let me try and see if I can do it again or not. Because sometimes the success, when it comes to you, you feel that, you know, you are arrived in life. So that was a time when I got this opportunity of Renault, which as a company had gone back out of India. Renault had a joint venture with Mahindra, and then that joint venture got broken in 2010, and then company was looking forward to coming back to India. And it's very tough thing. So in 2012, I joined Renault. At that point of time, there was hardly anything. Only 15 odd outlets in the country, and Renault became big after the launch of Duster. Duster was clearly, the reason was innovation, because there was a lot of innovation with that car. It redefined a segment. But after that, we started thinking what to do next. And one has to learn from his past. So obviously, if you see in India, not many global big players have been able to succeed in a market like India. So you may be number one, number two, number three in the world, but when it comes to India, you know, all the biggies have never been able to make it. So number one player, which is the market leader, has almost 50% market share even today, and the number two has got 17%. Between two of them, they have almost 67%. Nowhere in the world it's there. And a lot of companies started thinking about coming into the mini car, what we call the entry-level car, and they failed, because that's very, very tough. So the decision was, you know, what should we do? Should we bring all the big cars in India, or should we try to do something which is different? And I still remember we took this decision of launching a mini car. This I'm talking 2012. And when I was first time announcing this, people said, you have gone mad. Mini car, nobody has ever succeeded. Only two players in this country have ever succeeded. But if you see, interestingly, those two players are holding the market share for very long. And all of us know the pyramid. They are the only ones who succeeded in the bottom of the pyramid. Rest, all the players came somewhere in the middle of the pyramid, and they have not succeeded yet. Which means, probably one thought which was in my mind was, if you have to succeed, you have to succeed first at bottom of the pyramid, because that's how you build those loyalties with the customers. And we were working on three-pronged strategy after the launch of Duster. Whatever you have, manage it well. Get the best results out of it, get the best profitability out of it, build the brand strongly. So that was, at that point of time, Duster for me. But also the second point was, be disruptive. Before innovation, you need to be disruptive. And that's where we said, how can we be disruptive in mini car? And I'll share only two examples with you. First, when we were designing this project, so at Renault, just to share with you, my first mission was that we need to build a strong runway. So we created, we have a technology center today, R&D technology center, which has got 6,500 people working, not only for India, worldwide, based in Chennai. We have got two design centers in India. We have got a big plant in India. So you have to build a strong foundation, because, you know, India is a market for sure. You can't have a half-hearted approach. So when we were working on this car, we said we will build this car from scratch. Scratch. So just to tell you, and this is the car I'm talking, is Quid. Not even a fastener, a patch, is used from any other car. It was designed and built specially for this car. Now, when we were designing this car, we really went deep into understanding the consumer, what they want. So clearly, design, looks, lot of features. I won't go more into details of that. But key thing is, you need to have, if you have to win anything in India, you have to have 5 rights with you. And that's my belief. First of all, right product with right features, with right value, with right timing, and the last is right strategy. So for us, it was very, very important if we have to compete in a market like India, where, you know, even if you are selling a 3 lakh rupee car or a 1 crore car, customers is definitely going to ask you, you know, what is the mileage? That's the mindset. So we were working on this car, and you know, a lot of you, those who are engineering or science student, F is equal to MA, you know, so, which means if you have to have a better acceleration, better performance, you have to reduce the mass of the car, weight of the car. If you reduce the weight, which means you have to take the steel out of it. If you take the steel out of it, then obviously you have safety challenges. So how can you do it? And I still remember, you know, we talk about millennials. We had these young engineers sitting. And one of the guy came up with an idea. And that idea was, and this is what was implemented, is that in any car of that size, mini car, you have got roughly around 16 to 18 kg of fasteners, pitch. So what we did was, we did a very specialized new age technology welding, which made car more stronger, and we were able to take 6 kg of fasteners out, which means we never compromised on the safety of the car. And at the same point of time, we were able to reduce the mass. Rather, we made it more safe. So sometimes, as marketeers, we have to go and think out of box. That's what I mean by being disruptive. You have to bring disruption. You know, it was very easy for us to say, okay, we will use page from there, tire from there, XYZ, but no. So there are a lot of examples which I can quote about this car. And this was the first time. Renault is a 119-year-old company. And in its history, for the first time, a global car was getting conceived and launched outside of Europe. And that was India. So it was a global launch of this car. So it is still the biggest Make in India story, because we made this car at the time of launch, 98% localization. Even the market leader has not been able to do it. So you have to be disruptive. Another example I would like to give you of innovation, and this is again part of the journey. In May of 2015, I had showcased the car for the first time to people in India, 20th May. And we said we will launch this car around festive period. You know, September, October is a festive period in India. And the business we are in, you have to make sure, you are making a global car, so you have to make sure that till last minute you are checking quality. And I realized somewhere in June that we are delayed. We are delayed. Now imagine taking such a big risk of getting into mini car, which is, nobody has ever been able to win other than 2 players, and we are late, so which means we will miss the festive period. What to do? And that's where came the innovation. And I think a lot of credit goes to the young people in our organization. I think the management style today, you know, has to change. So you have to listen to more to your younger people, because they can come with ideas. And I can only share 2 ideas with you. I was with my leadership team and I said, guys, we are late. What to do? So they were not able to come with any creative idea. And then I had diagonal slice. I was meeting the guys, you know, those who were, you know, our younger managers. And I said, what can we do? So they came up with innovative ideas. I don't know how many of you would recollect. My car was not ready, but we had to display the car outside. So what we did with a lot of innovation, we had car which was hanging at airport. The car, all the display of the car was on a ramp, because actually the reason was, we could not have afforded the customer to open the gate because the car was not ready. But that's where the innovation came. We were not able to give test drive, so we went for Oculus technology, where, you know, in the malls we were giving test drive like that. And another interesting thing happened is that a lot of our dealerships were in progress of development. So we were the first automobile company. This idea came in by, again, you know, young people, and they said, why can't we make virtual showroom? Which means that we created a showroom in Delhi, and it was a virtual showroom where people can log in, take the demonstration live. 50 people can log in, you know, and this was every half an hour there was a demonstration show. And it was very, very successful for us. And then came, again, we were late. So we were not having the car, and we were approaching the festive period. And I had to take a call to launch a car or not to launch a car. And probably I can say this was the biggest ever professional risk I took in my 24, 25 years of career. Imagine the pressure I had to launch a global car, because if it doesn't succeed in India, it won't succeed anywhere, you know. And to launch a car without a single car at my dealership. We didn't have a single car at dealership to show. Not a single car for test drive. And we are getting into the most difficult segment. So virtual showroom was one innovation. And then I said, guys, you know, can we really sell the car online? Something in digital. Again, in my management team. And my team came back to me and said, no. There was one manufacturer who did that, and he was able to book only 87 cars. So it's not a great idea. Again, so few of our young managers came up with some directional thought, and I ended up meeting someone who was into this industry, and he said, why don't you think of an app? I said, there is no app in the country for a car. And that gave me an idea, and I said, okay, fine. I didn't share that with anyone, and I just told my assistant, please book a flight, and I want to go and meet the employees of this company. And I went to meet the employees of this company. This is a software company. And when I entered into the room, conference room, you know, they were delighted, you know, because never ever a car company CEO had ever come to their office. And I said, tell me what all we can do. And that's where they started polishing the idea. And they said, you should launch an app. With an app, what you do, you don't have a car, but a customer can have a virtual demonstration of the car. He can compare the car, and we will put e-commerce into it, and he can even book the car. Now, my management team was telling me only 87 cars somebody had ever done. And with that, we went ahead and launched the car in India. So virtual showroom, I'm just giving two examples, and this app. And with no car in showroom, nothing to test drive, and we were able to book 23,500 cars only on the app. You know, that is innovation. So manage what you have today, be disruptive, and after that, bring innovation. Because marketing, you know, maybe, you know, in this room we will have bigger marketeers. But whatever little knowledge I have, I can say marketing has completely changed in the last few years. You know, when we talk about the audience today, which is taking decision, they don't want to be told, you know, what to do or how to do. You have to be, first thing, what I believe, be simple and short. The content has to be very simple and short, to the point. They don't have time. A lot of time people say, millennials, oh, their attention span is very short, you know, so don't do things. No, their attention span is short because you are trying to do a lot of blah blah to them. You know, you give them content and they will stick to you. You have to be consistent. You know, I still remember the old marketing days, you know, okay guys, you know, we prepare for, you know, for 3 months, one big campaign, and then we relax and see, oh, what's the result? It's like playing golf. You hit the ball and then you see, oh, going there, and then you start walking. No, today the marketing is like squash, chak, 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 you know. You have to be consistently working in building your brand, you know, whether it is social media, whether it is digital space. But most important thing is there has to be a human element to it. Because after all the five rights I said, you know, right product, right features, you know, a right value, right timing, right strategy. Most important thing is you need to be authentic, because today's customer can clearly see what is the marketing gyan you are trying to give and what is the reality. And I think that's very, very important. So for an organization, it is so important to build your organization culture in line with consumer culture, because that's very important. If organization culture is something different and you are trying to build a brand on that, you know, which is talking something very different, you won't succeed. So I think I will stop here, because as I said, this is the conversation session. So I'll stop here, and obviously let me and Pradeep have some conversation. And as I said, this, let this not be a communication session. This should be a conversation session. So please feel free after that to ask any questions.
Thank you so much, Mr. Sawhney. That was an absolutely impressive and a fascinating journey. If it was not for real, one would have thought it was imaginary. Because, you know, from dusting the market with duster to making the quid count to now literally capturing the market with capture, I think you've successfully led a brand, a master brand in automobile industry, into a market which is one of the toughest automobile markets in the world. So I'd like the audience to give him a really big hand for all the success that he's delivered. I was fascinated by your address on multiple counts, and I thought there were a few queries and expansion that we could speak about, and then I would give the audience a chance to ask these questions. I think the first thing that you addressed from the heart was that instead of having communications, we should have conversations with the audiences, with the consumers. And obviously, in a business like automobile industry, your trade, your dealers also matter a lot. So how do you set up the right kind of listening posts to be able to hear the right insights, get the right insights, so that you are able to have meaningful conversations and you're not in your own imaginary world of what the audience wants? So what are the kind of listening posts that you think brand managers today and marketers today should really have in mind?
Most important thing is, you know, when we talk about today's marketing, the biggest question is how do we break these millennials? You know, how do we get their attention? But who best can really let you know how to break the millennials? The millennials in your own organization. You have to have an, you know, inside outward approach, which means you have to encourage people, especially the younger people, to sometimes validate your strategies. Because, you know, at management level, at middle management level, we think we know everything. But the reality is actually no. And at least I can talk about myself. I have learned so much in this journey. And it's still, you know, we have not arrived. It's still a journey for me. That every 15 days, every 15 days, and that is like I do this diagonal slice meeting, which is, and most of the audience are for sure, you know, less than 32 years of age, young managers. And I just have conversation with them for 1.5 hours, just to hear them. You know, it's not that I'm telling them something. Every 15 days, there are 20 people in the boardroom, and which means every month, I end up meeting almost 40 people. Because it's so important to understand how today's audience, the customer, is thinking, because that's where the purchasing power is. And I think I learned it by one of my boss many years back. We used to have these marketing pitches coming into, you know, every organization does marketing pitch. I'm sure a lot of agency guys would be there, and there was a pitch where we had the full battery, right from the CEO of the company to the, you know, the brand director or the creative director. So whole gang was there, and, you know,
The CEO was the biggest celebrity, one of the biggest celebrity in the country. And they said, okay, you know, we are here in the pitch, and stands up the creative director. Oh, so this is what we are going to do. And I had learned it from my boss, you know. And I said, you know, you sit down. The person who has worked on this strategy should stand up and give the presentation. And it was a big shocker, because actually that person was sitting not even on the boardroom table, on the side chairs. And we did this pitch with all the companies, and this was a surprise element. And finally, the pitch went to the company where the employee, the guy who had worked on the pitch, was able to convince me. So I think that's very important. And fortunately for us, you know, I can say we were having big challenge on a particular car. Not only on the advertising on the car, but overall brand direction. And then we changed the direction, and the results were 5 times better sales. So I think it's very important to listen. That's what at least my mantra is.
Oh, that's been an amazing precision. And I think the kind of insights that you've managed to get because of going right to the heart of the matter, right to the core of the subject, in especially the younger audience, you know, has clearly delivered the results to you. When we look at younger audiences today, Sumit, we earlier had in the presentations today, Mr. Amanpreet Bajaj, who is the country head of Airbnb. And you know, this millennial audience that we talk about is all into Airbnb, Snapchat, Uber. The generation today, I'm told, believes that owning a car is perhaps not as important as long as you have the use of a car. So why, you know, own a cow if all you need is a milk? So how do you, and I'm told that this is not just a trend, but it's a conversation that is happening in auto companies boards across the world, including GM and Ford, etc. How do you see a large automotive manufacturer such as yourselves coping with this expectation that the audience is actually going to fundamentally shift their purchase behavior and go into a completely new mode of consuming your product and service?
See, we have to see why this audience is changing their behavior. And this is not limited to younger audience. It means a lot of people, in especially in cities like Delhi, Mumbai, Bangalore, they are using these, you know, Olas and Ubers of the world because of the traffic condition. We have huge infrastructure problem, you know. So what they believe is where to park the car, what to do, you know. So this is the growing trend right now. Is it going to affect automotive industry to a very large extent? Probably my answer would be no. Because at the end of the day, we are in the business of selling car. So somebody will have a ride, you know, whether it comes through owning a car or sharing a car or you know, taking it on rent. But clearly we are thinking, what is going to be the future? So automotive industry, as I said, you know, we are seeing a lot of disruption. And when I talk about my company, you know, most of you would know Renault, Nissan and Mitsubishi, we are one alliance. So we are the world's largest automotive alliance today. And the future is what I call ACE. Autonomous cars, connected cars, and electric cars. So, and this is not a distant future. Today we have got autonomous cars, we have got connected cars, and we have got electric cars. And we are right now working on how we can bring such kind of technology in the emerging market. Imagine a situation. First of all, you know, government wants to bring a lot of change on infrastructure. You know, a lot of cars will go off with new regulations coming in, off the road, so we will have some space. And these autonomous cars, today's generation, they don't have issue in terms of financial power. Their biggest point is they don't want to be hassled. So imagine a situation where you are sitting in a car which doesn't require an IC engine, so it's small. It is autonomous. You just say, I have to go from this place to this place. The car will go on its own, and the cars will talk. And we have those cars with us. Huh? So it's not I'm talking some space age thing. Connected cars. So your entire, you know, Facebook, you know, Snapchat, XYZ, everything is there. You know, IoT of things will connect very clearly and tell you, you are on the way back home. By the way, pick up the milk, because the refrigerator, you know, will actually talk. And that's what we are working on. Plus electric cars, it's inevitable. A lot of people think, you know, you have heard government saying 2030, India will be 100% electric, and maybe 2 years back, all of us were laughing as automotive manufacturer. It won't happen, but I can tell you, it is coming. And my belief is it will come much before 2030. So I think, again, you have to bring disruptive and innovative technology.
Amazing, and I think that's what the audience is kind of looking forward to, and that's what the consumers are looking forward to. You know, there is a saying that business is all about marketing. I am sure it is more than that, but I think marketing is the face of the business that gets seen out there. Looking at your brand and the way it has evolved, I think Renault has created a lasting impression in the mind of the consumers. And one of the ways we in marketing see as that having manifested itself is through a lot of events engagement. You know, you were associated with the Sunburn Festival and a lot of other ideas. A lot of media people here, marketers, agency planners, and creative designers actually want to understand, how do you look at your choice of combination of media vehicles, given the fact that the audience preferences are shifting and that there is a demographic difference across various markets. So what is the thinking that goes into the ideal combination of media mix when you look at a go-to-market approach for, let's say, a new brand?
See, it also depends which car we are talking, but if we are talking about mother brand and we are talking about car, obviously, you know, digital is something which is really moving fast. But digital is such a big word, you know, there's a lot which is there. So I think most important is that you need to be getting into a mode of not communication but conversation, and that is where you get digital into play, because today's generation is not willing to watch your 30 second ad and, you know, clap. Gone are the days. They don't have time to read a newspaper. So that's why digital is catching up fast, and we see what kind of an audience we have to reach to. And you know, earlier, I remember many years back, we used to talk about demographic. Okay, you know, let's talk about this customer audience, less than 25 years, between, you know, 25 to 35 years. I don't think age is anything which you can track now. You have to track your customers by their social groups. I still remember, you know, and I'm sure a lot of us will agree, there were times, at least when I was growing up, I never had the courage to go to, you know, my grandfather to talk, have a conversation. Father was at best, but that also was not very easy, you know. And most of the times, whenever we were out in a social function, the youngsters were on one side, you know. They were not conversing with the elders. But today, if you see, you know, it's completely changed. The guy doesn't care, you know. He will call a 50-year-old guy with his first name, you know. So it is more important to catch the social group, what they are liking, rather than, you know, doing the demographic slicing. So that's how I believe, you know, when you do your media planning, you have to keep all these things in mind.
Awesome. I actually have tons of other questions, but in the interest of audience time, and I'm sure they're, you know, dying to ask a few questions, I'll save one for the last, which I'll ask at the end. And I think we have time for perhaps two or three questions at best. So please make it count. If you can just raise your hand if you have a question, we'll try and get a mic across to you. Yes, the gentleman. Hang on. Satya, I think you're number two, so you just have to wait. Can we get a mic over there, please? Gentleman in the third table player, please. Sir.
Hello. Yeah. I'm Anu Bose. I'm a senior advocate, Supreme Court. I'm also a special advisor to Tata Consultancy Services Limited. Now, we see India, as elsewhere in the world, is beset with what we find today is the impact of the fourth industrial revolution. You know, robotics, artificial intelligence, nanotechnology, automation, to the extent that it was a humanoid robot which greeted Modi and Ivana Trump in Hyderabad at the last summit.
Yes.
So I'm just asking this question, do you intend to ride on the wave of this fourth industrial revolution, the 10th, when you're offering new products? Would you, Renault, offer, say, a robotic driver or a chauffeur along with the car? Or would you offer a robotic female companion to a lonely driver who may need company? Science is progressing to that extent. Or maybe a robot to drop the little child in the school without the aid of the driver. Yeah. Now, these are things which will become real within the next 20 years. Japan already has moved ahead in this field, and the reason why they had a robot greeting Trump and Modi was to show India's impact also in this field.
Sure, sir.
Therefore,
thank you.
What is it that you, as the CEO and MD of Renault, feel? Do we ride the wave? And if we ride this wave, do we also have any checks or balances?
Thank you, sir. I'd request Mr. Sawhney to address the question.
See, yes, we should ride the wave, but we should ride the wave we want to ride the wave. That's very important. So I will answer your question in two parts. First, if you talk about fourth industrial revolution, and I go towards the production side, you know, a lot of countries have issue in terms of labor cost, so they are moving towards robots. So areas where you really need precision, for a country like India, we have got very skilled, intelligent manpower. So for areas where you need some precision, yes, robots, but otherwise you don't have to copycat. Because all of us know countries like Australia, the automotive companies have stopped manufacturing because of the labor cost. And even robots were not a substitute for that. Coming back to the consumer side of it, what I just mentioned earlier, autonomous cars, connected cars, are the reality, which means that you sit in your car, so they are like robots, you know what? You just put your destination, the car will take you there. And while you are there, you are not lonely because it is also connected. Your hands are free. So you can talk to not robot, but your wife, if somebody wants to, otherwise anyone. And obviously, you know, it will be much silent because IC engines are going. So it's like you sitting in your living room, you know, and we have all these space age movies, but that's all going to be a reality. Means when I was a child, trust me, you know, I used to think the biggest invention in my lifetime is this whole Skype, where I can see someone and talk, because I am from an era where, you know, you had to book trunk calls. And this was the biggest innovation in my lifetime yet, you know. So I think what we are saying, we will see that very soon happening on our own roads in India.
Fantastic. That's excellent. Could we have the next question, please? The gentleman in the center. I think in order to be gender balanced, I think there's a lady over there who has a question. Let's give her a chance, sir. Please, I'll definitely come back to you after this. Could you pass the mic along? Second row, second table. Could you just get that mic switched on, please? Thank you.
Hello, check. Yeah. Good evening, everyone. I'm Shalini from Lakshya Media. The question is that with increasing number of cars every day on the road, we have increasing pollution. So how is Renault going to be handling that? Because, of course, you will be wanting to have the production to increase, the demand to increase, and everybody buying more cars. Like everybody, they are four members, they are four cars plus a family car. But that's not going to help solve the traffic problem and the pollution. So what's the stand for the company on that?
Okay, so I don't want to give you a political answer because it's very easy for a car company CEO to say that. But I think there's a multiple level of strategy, at least I can talk about, I'm working. First of all, with the government, I was the first one 2 years back who said, please bring scrappage policy. Because on one side, we say we want to jump from Euro 4 equivalent, which we call BS4, to BS6 in 2020. So BS4 was implemented in entire India in 1st April this year. And we want to go to Euro 6 April 2020, which means 3 years, we want to do a quantum leap. Europe took 11 years to do it. So yes, that's a good step. Let's be disruptive. But we also have to get rid of old cars, which are 25, 30 year old cars, which are polluting. So government is now very positive towards that. And they're working on this strategy. And obviously, we are ready today to even give BS6 technology. And we were the front runners to say, please bring BS6 fuel earlier in New Delhi, at least, so that we can bring the cars, you know, firsthand. And the last point is, we are the world leaders in electric cars, world leaders. And this is what I think, you know, what we call ZE, zero emission cars. And we are, you know, I'm working with the government right now to work on the strategy, how India can transform towards electric mobility and how it could be good for us and how it can help the overall ecosystem. Because a lot of times you think electric car is like, you know, I will just drive my cars. No, you know, electric car will help in the grid stability, because, you know, when we produce electricity, so there are times when grid is, you know, cool. That's the time when cars will take energy. And when the grid is hot, you need energy. The cars can give back the energy to the grid. So that's the kind of an ecosystem we are working with the government at this stage. That's our involvement right now.
Amazing. That's seriously amazing. I'll give the gentleman a chance for the last question, since I promised it to him. We are running a little late on time, but I guess it's definitely worth it. I'll repeat the question. Why don't you just say it so that we save some time? Go ahead, sir. I can hear you. So I'll repeat the question that you ask. Please go ahead.
Who's looking into a target audience of 3 million ex-servicemen.
Right, sir.
We are finalizing something and we found something about Renault, which surprised me. Amongst the four names taken by them, Renault did not come into that for the simple reason that they felt your network in the rural areas is not strong. Your brand in the rural areas is not strong. So I thought, this is going to be finalized the next 1 week, and I'll meet you with it. I need 25,000 cars immediately within 1 month. But I'm just looking at, why can't Renault bring in reliability in the villages? Why can't people, even ex-servicemen don't believe in Renault? I want to ask you that question. Can Renault do something beyond the electric things, what you are doing? Because the basic need of India today is a car which is reliable, a service is reliable, and I need your support in that. And can Renault give it?
Yes. So first of all, I should thank you, because this was not a question, but a business proposition, and I'm always open for business.
Excellent.
But, you know, it's important, because Renault is still the youngest brand in the country. We are seventh largest player today in the country. So all the players, those who are holding 1 to 6 position, are at least 15 to 40 years in this country. And all the players, those who are below us, from 8 to 18, are also at least 10 years old. So we are the youngest brand, but that doesn't give me a reason to say that to a consumer. So we have increased our dealer network very, very drastically. I'll just give you one example. When we launched Quid, I had only 150 service outlets. Today, we have got almost 270 service outlets. But on top of that, by 31st December, I will have something called, which was again the first innovation in the country, called Workshop on Wheels. Because when we launched Quid, we thought this car will sell in Delhi, Mumbai, you know, Jaipurs and Ahmedabad of the world. What we saw, this car was going to interior villages, you know, and today, you know, I'm very proud to say, in less than 2 years, we have been able to sell more than 2 lakh Quid. Quid is the top 10 selling cars in this country for last 2 years. So we came with this concept of Workshop on Wheel. I said, by the time I'm building the infrastructure, and this Workshop on Wheel is a full workshop which goes from one village to another, and it's not a service van where you do, no, it opens up and becomes a workshop. So I'll be very interested to understand which are these areas, and by end of this month, we will have 75 of such workshop on wheels, and by next year, 150 plus more workshops. So at least I can assure you of that confidence. And on top of that, when we launched Quid, the biggest challenge for us, when I said 5 rights, one of the right was right value. Our cost of ownership, because we are 98% localized, my spare part value, you know, and I still remember the figure at which we launched, is 17%, 17%. 17% lower than the market leader. Probably, we are a younger brand, we still have to, you know, communicate. We need to converse more with this kind of customer. So I'll be very happy to, you know, have your details and share what all we can do. And I take this as a good business proposition.
Fantastic. I think you've got all the convincing reasons from Mr. Sawhney just now on why you should forget the other four and go only with Renault. So, sir, I think we, Mr. Sawhney will be available for a few questions thereafter. Please go ahead, sir.
See, at the end of it, I'd like to pay a compliment to your company. In the year 1917, the Indian Fourth Army saved Paris from the German attack. And in those 400, 600 Renault taxi cabs that saved Paris, most of the soldiers who traveled in those taxi cabs were Indian soldiers, and most of them were Sikhs.
Amazing. That calls for a big hand.
Which your company must highlight.
Thank you.
The Indian Fourth Army, which disrupted the Schlieffen plan. Fantastic. The Germans have faced their biggest defeat outside the gates of Paris.
Excellent.
Renault cars, 660 taxi cabs.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. On that note, I think I am coming to the last question, which I had reserved for myself. So if anybody has got other questions, I'll request Mr. Sawhney to perhaps address them one-on-one. So Sumitji, what's your personal success mantra? What motivates you? What gets you getting up in the morning and going? What drives you? Sorry, it's a longish one, but I guess that's
what really motivates me is my passion. You know, as I said in the beginning, sure. I love automobile. But trust me, you know, like most of us in life, this was not my first love.
Oh, is it? You know, that's surprising to note.
I wanted to be a fighter pilot. But I was not successful in that, so I ended up becoming a corporate executive, and that's my passion. My passion is building business, but apart from that, my passion is also flying. So I learned flying, so I love flying, and my other passion is that, you know, sometimes we end up. You know, when we talk about brand, I was talking about human touch. And you have to build a culture in your own organization, because I strongly believe in that famous saying, culture eats strategy for breakfast. Yeah. You can have great strategy, but if your organization doesn't have culture, if your people are not engaged with you, you know, you will not succeed. So so for me, that human touch is very important. So that is another side of me where I love to go out in villages, and my biggest, I would say, achievement now is that we have built a 125-bedded hospital. Wow. In a village in Madhya Pradesh. I don't belong to Madhya Pradesh. So, you know, when you get something, you should always give it back to the society. So these are few of my passion which drives me every day.
Absolutely amazing and totally inspiring. Ladies and gentlemen, I think a really big hand is called for.
Thank you very much. And at this point, let me also invite Mr. Krishna Menon, CMO for Sakal Media Group, to join us on the stage to facilitate with a small memento for Mr. Sawhney and Mr. Dwivedi, please. Welcome. You can put a round of applause, ladies and gentlemen, for that one. Thank you. Thank you.